Okay, we're going to begin. It's not Hashem tonight. We're going to begin a new series on Shir Hashirim, the Song of Songs that was composed by Shlomo HaMelech Solomon. It is a book that I intended to give over many years ago when we did Kohelet, Ecclesiastes, and Mishlei, Proverbs. They're all very beautiful and important books and actually very relevant. So we've come to the last one of the three, Shir Hashirim, the Song of Songs. It's actually the one that's least understood because Shlomo HaMelech speaks in parables. They're very beautiful words and they appear to be romantic in nature, but people misunderstand it. Unless you really review the entire book, then perhaps you will get a feeling for what he really is trying to communicate to us. There are different opinions as to which of the three he wrote first. As you know, he didn't live too long. I think it was about 52, 53 years. Very short life. Of course, it was a life of great achievement. He was a king after all. But he was also a very wise king. And throughout life, we all hopefully will become wiser and gain experience. So Shlomo HaMelech initially, according to some opinions, began to write Shir HaShirim, the Song of Songs, a very special song in which he describes the relationship, the connection between the Jewish nation and God. And this is what we will be talking about, but tonight will be an introduction. Later on in life, he wrote Mishlei, Proverbs, a lot of what he learned by experience, very useful, which we have a whole series of lectures about. At the end of his life, according to some opinions, he wrote Kohelet, Ecclesiastes, where he describes how everything is vain. A bunch of vanities. People are so distracted and they lose focus of what's really important in life. So at the end of his life, he looks back and he's able to analyze and he's able to share with us that from all that he has seen and experienced, and remember, he's a wise man, he's a knowledgeable man. It is, I can tell you from my own personal experience, believe me, trust me. Be careful, there's a lot of things that will distract you. So do yourself a favor, learn as much as you can early on so that you don't make the mistakes that many people have made. Even though Shlomo HaMelech put this together, our tradition says that Hezkiyahu the king and a group of scholars are the ones that put it together and made it part of the Ketuvim, part of the Bible. But in order for us to properly understand this book as we read through it, we need to first understand, we need to first know, what is a shir, what is a song? And here we're talking about the Song of Songs, so there's something unique about it. But what is a song exactly? I've already given a lecture about music, the language of the soul, where we cover many of the principles behind music, how special it is, what it does for us. But here we're breaking it down. We're talking not about music in general, but about a song. A song, briefly, we can describe as an expression of the emotions of the heart. We all have emotions, and those are felt. We feel those emotions from time to time, but they can be expressed. And one way of expressing those emotions is through a song. It also expresses our deep thoughts, not just the emotions, but our deep thoughts as well. And as a result of putting together a song, not just the words of it, not just the lyrics, but the music that accompanies it, we're actually creating a composition here. A composition that has the power to connect. So in the end, a song has a tremendous ability to form a connection. So what we actually see in the production of a song is the process, as the Kabbalah explains, begins with a thought. It continues on to the speech, and it continues after that into a maaseh. So we have machshava, dibur, and maaseh, the thought, where the seed is planted, and later on it's expressed verbally, and later on it produces something, it produces a maaseh. What's the maaseh? What is exactly produced? The effect that it has on us, the effect that it has on people who are listening to the words and the music. Shir HaShirim is very different than Tehillim. Baruch Hashem, we've done a whole series on the Book of Psalms by the father of Shlomo, David HaMelech. Very powerful book. A book that is recognized all over the world. The words of which are very important to be said because they give us a lot of clarity, and they are prayers as well. They're not just psalms, but they act as prayers where we make requests. And that is why traditionally we have a very clear tradition that if we're in trouble, we're experiencing something like David HaMelech experienced in his life, we should say some of those chapters that are very propitious to asking Hashem to come to our help. And it's a very, very unique book because it covers just about everything. It covers the amazing wonders of Hashem that we should analyze, which would strengthen our faith if we did. It covers praises to Hashem, gratitude, and thanks for the time that David HaMelech, in this case, was victorious. And he basically tells us, do the same as I do. Don't just take things for granted. There is Hashgacha, there's divine providence. You would have noticed that in your life, perhaps, unless you didn't pay attention. And some of them we covered in coincidences. There are no coincidences. So David HaMelech in Tehillim brings out a lot of perspectives, proper perspectives of how to see life, what to do if you're in trouble. And of course, if you have a need, everything is covered in Tehillim. Very, very special, very beautiful and important book. Shir HaShirim, however, does not deal with personal requests. It does not deal with all the problems that people may have and experiences that the David had in his life that we may have. It explicitly deals with a connection, a very powerful connection that Hashem has with us, the Jewish people. But it also describes a powerful connection that can exist between Hashem and any human being, any soul that craves to connect to Him. And there are some beautiful souls out there who don't happen to be Jewish, but they are very special nonetheless. They're pure, and they feel attracted to spirituality. They feel that this is something important to them in their life, and they wish they had a language through which they can connect to Hashem. So even though prayer is definitely a way to connect to Hashem, you will be surprised, but there are many, many words in Shir HaShirim that actually describe what one should feel and what Hashem feels as well for us in wanting to have that connection. So it's not only that here we are longing for a connection, Hashem is also longing for that connection. And that connection can apply to any human being in this world who realizes at some point in his life that life is a lot greater, or there's a lot more to life than what the eye can see. And as we search, and some people are searching, not everyone, but some people are searching, you will find the tools. You will for sure find the tools, hopefully the right tools, that will show you the way, the path to make that connection. And when we talk about connection, it's not only a connection with God. I mean, that's a very powerful connection. But as you will see from Shir HaShirim, one of the ideas that he conveys to us is that love is behind that powerful connection that we're talking about. Something called love that many people misunderstand. And when we talk about love, we're not just talking about the love that we should have for Hashem, because He has that love for us. He created us. He gave us life. He only wants to do good for us. But that's the kind of feelings that we should have for another human being. As the verse says, "Ve'ahavta le'racha kamocha," the Torah says very clearly, you should show love and care. And I emphasize care because that's really the essence of love, is to care for someone else. You should show it to another human being. You should have a solid friendship with someone. You should be kind unto others. So we're talking about all kinds of connections, husband and wife. Many, many, many times, unfortunately too many times, that connection suffers. It's a poor connection. And many times it's poor communication. And the question is, how do we improve it? Well, part of it is through these beautiful words. Words can make a difference, but they can also be empty words. And that's where feelings are important too. That's where actions speak louder than words. So we need all of that. But you will be amazed how much a song can make a difference. There are many songs in the Torah. Rabbis tell us that basically, if you count the songs, you will have 9 songs. You could count the song of Moshe when they left Egypt, as Shir Moshe. You can count the song of Miriam. You can count the song of Devorah. These are songs. And these are songs of praise to Hashem, of gratitude to Hashem, pointing out the hand of Hashem in the miracles that they experienced. But the 10th one is unique. The 10th one will be sung when Mashiach comes. And as we explained in the series of Tehillim, more in detail what that song is all about and why it's unique. And it cannot be sung now. In other words, life as we know it right now is still missing something. Even though there's a lot of details, there's a lot of history behind us, there's something missing. And that something is called the tachlit, the ultimate destination, the ultimate goal of where we're heading. Something that people don't think about, people don't know about. Is there such a tachlit? Yes, tachlit is Mashiach, the final redemption, when God reveals himself, when we finally figure out what was this all about? Why was there pain and suffering? What is life? Very difficult to ascertain today, very difficult to figure out. Of course, the Torah teaches us, the rabbis have taught us a lot, and that helps. But we don't have complete clarity, otherwise that would interfere with free will. When will we have a lot more clarity when Mashiach comes? At that point, when everything becomes crystal clear, that people did not just die in vain. When we see the dead rise, the song will be indescribable. Something so difficult for us to even imagine what kind of a song it will be, but it will be a song of such great joy and happiness that we have gained clarity that we did not have. And that is why I always tell people, if you would only learn, you would be happier because you would understand certain things that without the knowledge you do not know. And to be ignorant is very painful. It's actually, for some people it's great, but they'd rather not know anything. But it's such a waste of a life not to be able to know as much as we can. If Hashem has given us the tools, the brains, to learn, to analyze, to ask questions, and we don't do so. Mashiach, therefore, when he comes, and he will come very soon, will be a time of great joy, a time when we will be able to connect in the strongest way possible, a connection that sometimes we struggle to form as we go through life, because of the ups and downs of life, because of the various problems that people have, and there are all kinds of problems. And I'm not even talking about war. I'm not talking about tornadoes that disrupt people's life in a very painful way. I'm talking about personal problems that people have, not necessarily with others, but with themselves, trying to figure out themselves. And you'll be surprised. A song can make a difference. So when Shlomo HaMelech put this together, he put it together in a way of a song, but he used words that we can relate to and we can understand. Even though it's deep, very deep. The rabbis explained to us that this was all divinely inspired. It's not just plain words because Shlomo HaMelech was a wise man and he just wanted to share with us what he thinks, his opinion. No, this was all divinely inspired. It's deep. It's Kabbalistic. There's a lot of ideas being expressed here in few words, but he uses words that we're familiar with because otherwise we would not be able to understand these concepts. Love is something very, very deep. And he uses words that are familiar to us in order that we should be able to follow what he's trying to say. So you may get the wrong idea for someone who is looking at the book for the first time. Oh, this is so romantic. Let's make another song out of it. And some people have tried to compose songs using his words. The rabbi says, be careful. This is not just plain words. This is deep. He uses plain words. He uses words that we can relate to, that we can understand, because the deeper concepts we would not be able to understand. So the appearance of it is that this is romantic, but it's not. It's about a deep connection, about a powerful connection that is called love, of course, But that love is misunderstood. What exactly is love? So Shir Hashirim is called the Song of Songs. Why the Song of Songs? Because there are many songs, but this is the Song of Songs, meaning that this is the most special one of all. So when you see the words Shir Hashirim, just keep in mind, this is the most special one of all, even though there are others. And because it's so special, the rabbis remind us that even though there's a lot of holy scriptures, they're Kodesh, but this is Kodesh Kodashim. Shir Hashirim, they say, this one is the holy of the holiest. If we were to explain those words in a simplistic way, it means that this is very, very special. Even though everything is important and everything is holy, there's something about Shir Hashirim that makes it very holy. And even though there are various explanations as to why this is very special, let's just keep in mind that the rabbis, by emphasizing that this is Kodesh Kodashim, this is the holy of the holiest, they are reminding us, take these words seriously. They're very special. Even though they're presented to you in a simple way so that you can understand and follow, don't therefore come to any wrong conclusion that this is just a love song. No, be careful that this is holy. It's deep. So what's unique about it? What's so special about Shir Hashirim? Other than being divinely inspired, it is a song about love. It is a song about the relationship between us and Hashem. But what kind of a relationship? So the rabbis tell us that what happened when we left Egypt was the engagement of the Jewish people with Hashem. That was the beginning of a relationship, Erusim. When Mashiach comes, that will be the Nesu'in, that will be the marriage. That's when we will all rejoice. And that is, of course, a wedding that no one can imagine what it will be like. But that will be the culmination of everything that has happened for so many years. Here we're going through a movie, if we can call it that, and there's many ups and downs. There are some scenes that are beautiful, and there are some scenes that are not so beautiful, and they're even painful, like the Holocaust, the various inquisitions, the various crusades, pogroms, you know, but you have to look at the whole thing. And because we only live so long, one generation, we're not able to see so much. We have some advantage over the past that we're able to look back, but it's not easy if you look back. It appears to be very, very sad. Some of our history is very sad. But when the marriage comes through, once we are holding at the end, the tachlit, the ultimate goal of all of this, we will be able to see the whole thing. And we will rejoice in realizing that everything that has happened was for our own good, our own benefit. So as we read Shir Hashirim and we see that it's all about a loving relationship that began as an engagement, we are reminded of something very important. We're reminded, yes, throughout all these years, there may have been some sad episodes. And you may think that those sad episodes represent that Hashem, God forbid, has divorced us. He kicked us out of our country, after all, several times. The temple was destroyed twice. Look at all those persecutions. You may get the wrong impression when you analyze that history as you live through it. And Shir Hashirim comes to remind us, we're talking about love here. True love, pure love, sincere love, not fake love. Hashem made a promise, a commitment, and He will keep it. Don't be misled by what others are telling you. And many told us, oh, your God abandoned you, and He now made a new religion out of us. Yeah, this was said, and I think it's being still said today, when that's what some people think. Oh, you guys messed it up. You're stubborn. Look what you did. And of course, we make mistakes. It's only human to make mistakes. But there's something called teshuvah. There is something called repentance. People who have had problems can make up. There is something called making up. What about that? Forgiveness? So, Shir Hashirim is important because it reminds the Jew, Hashem did not abandon us, did not divorce us, did not cancel the wedding. This happens. People get engaged and they cancel the wedding. no, this did not happen to you. He still loves you. And this is a real love. He made a commitment. And he will keep his commitment. And we see that from the words of the prophets too, that there will come a time when all those prophecies that they said, and some of them already have fulfilled themselves, the rest will also fulfill themselves. You will see that. We see it today, if you pay close attention to what's going on in the world. So this is an important promise. If you read through the Song of Songs chapter by chapter, you will notice that he's reassuring us that no divorce ever occurred or will ever occur. Nobody can separate us from him. And unfortunately, some have tried. And you think it's been just other nations and other people? No, from within you, unfortunately. From within the Jewish nation came out false prophets who gave us a lot of troubles, hard times. Unfortunately, too many of them. If you read history, you will see that there were people who began new cults. Cults that supposedly represent Judaism, but they're all fake and they're dangerous. All kinds of cults. What they all have in common is that they're called false prophets. The Torah says you're going to have them. The Torah is telling us in advance, there will be people like that who will try to mislead you. But what's all that about? How could that happen? How come Hashem lets it happen? Well, first of all, let's not forget, there is something called kohot hara, impure forces, bad and evil people. There is such a camp. They exist. There's no denying it. Throughout history, you can see who was bad. Evil. It will always be around. What can we do? So there's no doubt that there's a competition here between the good and the bad. So something that is very evil, obviously it can be dangerous, it can mislead, it can be very powerful. And you will have exposure, unfortunately, to these forces from time to time. It's just part of Hashem's plan. Let's not get into that why, but they're just there. And they can, of course, come out as false prophets. But then, let's not forget that there are many pituim, many temptations. From time to time, a human being can be tempted. He can fall. He's at a great spiritual height, and even the best of the best have fallen, have been tempted, have been bribed. This can happen to the best of people. People can be corruptible, and I have a whole lecture about that. What does corruption do? A lot of countries today in the world are suffering from corruption, corrupt politicians, corrupt leaders, and it's incredible. Wealthy countries with tremendous potential and resources who are still behind. Countries are not developing. Wow, I'm just amazed at this, really amazed. But I shouldn't be, because the answer is, this is what corruption is all about. Lies, the power of the lie, the power of the impure forces, the power of people who are evil. And if they have a position of authority, we should never be in their hands, God forbid. They have the wrong values, the wrong ideas of what life is. They don't see the tachlit before them. They're not focused on what is the purpose of all of this. And therefore, they're limiting themselves to power and greed. That's it. Power and greed. They want to be in control. But what for? What are you going to get from this? Sooner, before you realize it, you have to leave and give over your job to someone else. Why hurt people? Why abuse them? Why control them? Yeah, people are not focused on the right things. So here, Shir HaShirim, it helps us. It helps us, especially if we're going through hard times. Don't be misled by these false prophets, by all these temptations, by thinking that perhaps these people may be right about what they say. No, no, no. Hashem loves you, cares about you, and you have seen it time after time through the various miracles. But Shir HaShirim does not only talk about how important this connection is and how much there is pure love. It also talks about what we call in Hebrew, gaguim. There's a very, very special word in Portuguese that cannot easily be translated into other languages, called saudades. What that means, the closest word in English would be longing, to long for something. What is to long is to have those deep feelings that I mentioned earlier, to stir up those emotions, to bring them to the surface, to want something very, very, very much. And this is not lust, this is not a desire, this is a longing for something that you know is beautiful and special, but you can't have it yet. So in Shir HaShirim, he reminds the Jew, don't despair. You're in a very, very difficult situation, don't despair. And you know how you cannot despair, even though you're going through difficult times? Focus on the taklit, on the ultimate goal, and long for it. Desire it very, very much. Truthfully, sincerely, because something that is sincere and pure comes from the heart. It's not just words. So we're not just talking about saying words like many, many people say. Long for it. Long for the Mashiach. When was the last time you begged Hashem in your own words? Hashem, please bring the Mashiach. Please bring the world out of its misery. Please, you know, we beg you. And do it for you, for your sake, not for us. Do it for your sake, that the world should see the truth. So here we had the Song of Songs bringing out what the right thing for us to do. In this way, we will not be so tempted by the temptations, the many temptations out there. We will not be discouraged. We will not fall in the trap of the false prophets. And hopefully, those beautiful words in Shir HaShirim will also provide us with the right words, the right strong feelings that we should have in order to be able to long for Mashiach, in order to be able to want to form that connection. So we're given the words, we're given the means, the tools to be able to create that connection. Otherwise, a normal average human being does not just from one day to the other form a strong connection. In order to be faithful, you have to be mature. You have to understand what a relationship is about. What do I want out of this relationship? Why am I getting married? Why should I observe mitzvot commandments? Even though we don't have full clarity about everything, but nonetheless we have enough information that can help us, in guiding us towards this ultimate goal. And if we don't try it, if we don't use it, then obviously nothing's going to happen. It's like telling someone who's sick, you got to take the medication. We can't help you otherwise. If you take it, you have a chance to survive. You have a chance to stay healthy. If you don't take it, there's nothing we can do. So here we're being given the tools to form that connection, because on our own, by ourselves, just without any tools, how do you make connections? Husband and wife, they get married. They need to be connected, always. But they're so different. They speak different languages. How are they going to always say committed, connected? They got to learn the secrets of the trade. They got to have the tools. They got to know what it takes to make the wife happy, what it takes to make the husband happy. There are certain tools that are tested, that are known to work for normal people, by the way. Obviously, if one of the two or the two of them are not normal, then nothing will help. But a lot of times we're dealing with normal people, a normal couple, just that their communication is not healthy or it's lacking. They need the tools, they need the direction. And the same thing is with the relationship between us and Hashem, between us and another fellow individual. You want to form a relationship. He's your partner, he's your student, he's your child. Whatever. There's all kinds of relationships. And obviously, the two of them have to be sincere about it. If one of them really wants to give to the relationship, the other one doesn't, then it won't work. That happens too. So here we're dealing with mostly the relationship between us and Hashem, because that's what really matters now. Because if you don't have the basic tools in forming a relationship, you will never reach that goal. What do I mean by that? The rabbis tell us that if you cannot form a basic relationship, a simple relationship with another human being, then how could you be expected to form a relationship with him who you do not see? So you need the basics, and the basics is learn to live with another human being. be respectful of another individual, regardless of religion right now. We're not talking about religion here. We're talking about human beings. They're all created in the image of God. They're all unique and special in some way. Everyone has something to contribute, otherwise they wouldn't be here. But people don't think like that. And they become racists and bigots and all kinds of things because they don't realize the beauty and how special every human being is. So if we cannot form a relationship, a healthy relationship with another human being, then this is a lot more remote and not as accessible, the relationship with Hashem. So once again, in Shir HaShirim, Shlomo HaMelech shows us the way. He shows us how much Hashem cares for us, how much He longs to have a relationship with us. We should have the same. It should be reciprocated. Perhaps through these ideas that are expressed in, I guess you could say, parables, Mishalim, uses all kinds of words to express to us how we should feel. Because that's the way He feels. Even though He's not physical, He's not human, and He doesn't really have those feelings. But in order for us to understand it, Shlomo uses human feelings, human words, human expressions that should be able to relate to us. There's one big difference between the Song of Songs and the other songs in the Torah, which are also special. The Song of Moshe Rabbeinu, Az Yashir Moshe, coming out of Egypt by the splitting of the Red Sea, the Song of Devorah, the prophetess. Those were songs that have to do with war. There was a war involved, whether it was the Egyptians or whether it was someone else. So they relate completely to this world, that which is physical, even though, of course, they're expressing their thanks to Hashem. Shir HaShirim is called Shir HaShirim Asher Li Shlomo, which is to Solomon. What does it mean, Asher Li Shlomo, to Solomon? It's telling us who authored the book. No, it's more than that. The rabbis tell us that Shalom is another name for Hashem, peace. Even though it also indirectly tells us that Shlomo HaMelech put this together, his name is there after all, but in the end it's talking about Hashem. L'Shlomo is usually meant to refer to Hashem, to God. This is a song of peace, not about war. Peace. Another very, very powerful word. What do we mean by peace? Harmony. When you have a beautiful composition, beautiful songs, you have harmony, peace. Hopefully, if things are done properly in life, you will have what's called peace of mind. So this is not just about having a peaceful relationship, which it is, but also inner peace, which a lot of people don't have. If people do not have inner peace, how could they be in a peaceful relationship with another human being? There's a storm going on in their mind, in their heart, a storm. Very difficult for them to be in peace with someone else, in peace with Hashem. But it's possible, it's possible. And in this book called Shir HaShirim, Shlomo HaMelech pretty much describes to us how Hashem is in peace. He really is in peace with us, but we misunderstand Him perhaps. Misunderstanding, a big problem in life, that people do not understand each other properly. How are we going to understand Hashem? So it's a song about peace, and a song that hopefully will enable us to have that inner peace that we sometimes don't have and that we yearn for. You will notice in going through Shir HaShirim that in Shir HaShirim, Solomon describes the history of the Jewish people at the various stages. He describes the past, the present, and the future. What for? It's not just about the history of the Jewish people, it's not only to demonstrate to us how Hashem was always with us and never left us, but when you describe all three parts of our history, past, present, future, you're seeing a connection. The connection between all three as one unit. As one unit that leads us to the goal, that leads us to our final destination, to our destiny. As the rabbis and commentaries explain, when you start off with wheat, you don't understand where this is going. But eventually that wheat can be grinded down to become flour. And eventually that flour can be made into a cake. The cake is the ultimate goal. That is why the wheat is there. That is why it's grounded, in order to lead us to what we eventually want. And that is what we are supposed to want. We're supposed to want to get to that goal, to that destination. But what about those people who do not know what that goal is? So Shlomo HaMelech presents to us a picture of the past, our past history, our present, regardless of where you're holding that history, and reminding us, hey, we're not there yet. You don't see the whole picture yet. You need to know what that goal is, what that destination is. And that is the redemption, the ultimate redemption, the geulah, the final redemption. So, in putting this together as a song, even though it's the history, it is ultimately intended to awaken us. People are asleep. They don't realize what's going on, that there is a past, a present, and a future. So he uses those words in a powerful way as a love song. It does appear like a love song of yearning, of longing, of wanting to become together. What for? To awaken us, not only so that we not despair and lose track of where we are and where we're headed, but also to awaken us to also want to have those feelings, because it would be a shame. If you cannot have those strong feelings for another human being, you're losing out. You're losing out a lot. You know what love is? You have no idea how powerful love can be. It's a powerful connection. It's a glue between human beings and between us and Hashem too. Because if you will have that feeling of love towards Hashem, you will not despair. You will not give up. You will not feel as much pain. So this is something that He wants to awaken in us. There's a saying that I once saw. A good song never expires. And therefore, you will definitely want to listen to it over and over, because it does something to you. So, by reading Tehillim, not just reading it, but trying to understand, of course, the words, by reading Shir HaShirim, by even reading Mishlei, Kohelet, all the books of the Torah, you'll be surprised what it does for you. It's like a beautiful song that you want to hear over and over again, because you feel it does something positive to you. I very much recommend, by the way, that other lecture that I gave about music being the language of the soul. How to express feelings in a musical way. Very, very interesting topic. But here we're talking about a book. We're not talking about musical instruments per se, but a book that contains words. Nonetheless, those words, if we study them and we try to understand as best as possible what they're telling us, they will have a similar effect as music. I saw another saying once that says, a song can connect you better than any therapist. A song has that ability to make a connection better than a therapist. In other words, sometimes people go to therapists, but a song, a beautiful song, can do a much better job. So since we're speaking about love, what's the significance of love? And how was it actually implemented? We're talking about the love between us and Hashem. Obviously, love is a high level of connection, but there's also the level of fear. But fear not in the way that we understand fear, that we are afraid. Fear meaning awe and respect to Hashem. All of these are connections that are necessary. Otherwise, people lose interest and they disconnect. So in order to bring this about, there was a Beit HaMikdash, the temple, two times. And this temple was not only, as the Kabbalah explains, to bring down the divine presence into this world, a place where we can turn to, pray to, and remind ourselves of Him, but it was also a place where we can actually bring about those levels of fear and love. How? The fear was brought about through the tremendous respect that we had for that unique place, in keeping our distance, in how we entered the place, how we dressed. So all those rules that applied to the Beit HaMikdash, the temple, were intended to bring about that fear, that respect for that place, for the service that was going on there. Sacrifices. Some people say, what do you need sacrifices? So what do you need to butcher an animal and sprinkle its blood? So a lot of the things that went on there could have puzzled many, many people. So there are many, many rules there on how to bring about that fear and respect so that we should not lose track of what we're doing. What exactly is the priest doing there? We need to have that respect. But there's also the love. The love for Hashem, which is a very, very high level of connection. And how can that be seen there? Through the Keruvim, which were not seen, except for once a year, perhaps. Keruvim, remember those cherubim, I think they're called in English, two little kids with wings, made out of pure gold, and placed on top of the ark of the Aron as a cover. Why have that kind of a design? Why not just put a plain cover of gold, seal it, or whatever? What's that for? The explanation given for the Keruvim, one of the explanations is that look at them, they're kids. Those are images of kids with wings. And that represents love. Look how they face each other, not away from each other. Kids who are pure. Angels who are pure. We're talking about purity here. Love should be pure, not lust. As I mentioned earlier, a lot of times people do connect, but in a very superficial way. Not in a deep way, not in a true way. Because of lust, because of the passion that they have. That doesn't last. Are you wondering why marriages or relationships don't last? Because it's not deep, it's not real. Look, this is love. They're facing each other. They want to be with each other. They're little children who are pure. They don't have thoughts of lust and passion. They're like angels who are for sure pure. That is the idea. One of the ideas represented in the Keruvim. Pure gold. Everything is about purity. So because the love for Hashem is a powerful connection, obviously this is something that we should strive for. This is something that we should try to maintain all our lives. This is something that we should aim for, want it. Not just read about, oh, it's a beautiful thing. No, it's something that is possible for every human being to have. Same is true with other relationships. A loving relationship where one cares and one is not selfish. Because it's either one or the two. Either you are selfish and you don't want to be loving of somebody else, or you're prepared for self-sacrifice and hard work because you want to connect with someone. You realize that this is the goal. This is what I want. This is the kind of home I want to have. This is the kind of home I want my children to see because I want them to be like me and my wife. It's not easy. No, it's not easy, but it's possible. The Torah tells us that it's a commandment. You should love your fellow Jew as yourself. How do I do that? Care about him. It's not just about having feelings, because it's difficult to have strong feelings towards someone else as you have towards yourself and your family. Yeah, but you can care for them. You can respect them. There's different grades of feelings and connections. And when we read through Shir Hashirim, you will see that there's different kinds of ways to connect to someone through a handshake. It could be through a hug, and it could be through a kiss. And I intentionally mention it now because you will be surprised when we talk about a kiss. He's talking about a kiss. I mean, that's really romantic. And what does that have to do with us in the Shem? You'll be surprised because there are various grades of connections, some stronger than others. A handshake is very simple. You can say, you can shake someone's hand and say goodbye. What's the connection there? A hug is a lot more, right? You would agree. Much more powerful. But you know, I'm very surprised. I always tell it to my wife and to others. I don't think I've seen that warmth in the United States of America, or even in Europe, of a hug the way I see it in Latin America. For some reason, the people in this country are a lot cooler. And even though they can be very friendly and they can really connect, but in a different kind of way. I don't know why. It's a mentality, a different kind of mentality, which I'm not used to. I don't understand it very well. It's missing something. And even though sometimes a hug could be fake too, oh yes, many, many times even kisses are fake. People do it just because it's a ritual. On the three times, by the way. On the right cheek, on the left cheek, and then again on the right cheek. Yeah, what for? They're capable of stabbing the other one in the back after they leave, after the kiss. What's that all about? It's fake. Obviously, I'm not talking about those. A real kiss, a real hug, can be very, very special, very, very warm, very, very real. And obviously, when we talk about the relationship with Hashem, we're not talking about those terms. That terminology, nonetheless, is used for us to understand what he's talking about. Something that's powerful, something that you don't want to let go, something that you long for, that if you haven't seen him for such a long time, you miss him, as we say in English. You miss that person. Do you really miss him? What does that mean, you miss him? Yeah. That is some indicator of how strong your relationship is. And that is what we should have as we look forward to Mashiach, as we look forward to the redemption. Do you really want it? Do you really care about it? Borrow from these words, those feelings, or arouse them in yourself in some way. And have them, because they're very, very special, very important to have. So in talking about songs and music, how does this relate to the rest of the world? Even though here we're talking about the emphasis, the focus being on the Jewish people, I said earlier that this can apply to anyone. Well, remember that music is a universal language. There's music everywhere. Everybody loves music. Different kinds of music, but music is a universal language. And you know what this music will do? I was thinking how music affects us in different ways. And what came to my mind is, perhaps you've seen it occasionally too, that there are people that take sometimes old photographs, black and white, and they add color to it, and it brings it to life. It does something to it. Could you imagine a black and white world? Life is just black and white. It would be dull, not as interesting. Color brings happiness. Color brings life. Music brings life, brings happiness, elevates our moods. It's like adding color to black and white, and it's universal. Yes, there are songs I know that are very, very depressing. They bring out pain. They make you cry, perhaps, very emotional. There's all kinds of music out there, but they have an effect. That's the point I want to bring out. They do have an effect. So imagine a music that brings life and joy and elevates your spirits. That's universal. It applies to everyone. So all these songs that are being spoken about in Shir Hashirim, in the end, what do they do for us? They hopefully will elevate our mood, give us hope, and enable us to express that longing to be with Hashem, to be one, to see the Geulah, to see the redemption. Because as long as we're in the diaspora, we're in exile, it's very easy for people to lose hope and to despair. So a Jew needs to be reminded, which is what Shlomo HaMelech does. Look forward. Look forward to a better day. Look forward to the Mashiach. Look forward to the Geulah. People today are sad because of the corona. Yeah, that's one of the things. Should I take the vaccine, Rabbi, or not? I already took one. Should I take the second? Should I take a booster now? It's really confusing what's going on in the world, because especially when you have people saying, this is dangerous for you. Experts, we're not talking about simple people. Experts talking about how dangerous this could be. And by the way, they could be right. They could be right. People have allergies, don't they, to certain foods? People could be possibly allergic and having some side effects to some of this new technology. It's possible. Usually vaccines are good. Vaccines save lives. And you know, people who are very weak and susceptible to disease or have other problems should really do something to protect themselves besides vaccination. Be careful. You obviously, and I have a whole lecture about that, where people have to be careful and listen to the experts. But the problem today is there's so much confusion. Who should we listen to? So I'm not here to just give opinions as to who is right and who is wrong, because we don't know with 100% certainty what will happen in the future. We just know that we're facing a big dilemma now. There's a dilemma where there's a sort of plague, a disease, that is not going away so easily. And there's now strains, different strains, coming back. But what's going to be next year? So this is the generation that we're living in. And this is just some of the problems that we have to deal with. But there are many others that people forget about. What about the problem that many families are broken? Shalom bayit, the fact that there's no peace at home. Don't forget about that. Don't put that on the sidelines. You know, that is a very serious problem too. That deserves a lot more priority. Because here we're dealing with health. Okay, health is important for sure. But building relationships, relationship with Hashem, that our prayers should be stronger, that our mitzvot should be properly done, not as a routine. These deserve a lot of attention too. But people don't have enough tools. They just go and try to make a living, wake up, have breakfast, go out for, to dinner, to some restaurant. They don't think about, what am I doing here? What's life for? If they did think about these things and got some of the answers, they would feel better. They would realize, I have something to long for, to look forward to. And that is a mitzvah, to look forward to Mashiach. How many people look forward to Mashiach? Somebody might say, oh, only Chabad. They talk about, we want Mashiach now, but that's not true. That should not be the case. We say it in our prayers. We look forward to seeing you again in Yerushalayim when you rebuild the temple. Berachamim, with compassion. Why with compassion? Because we don't want war. We want to go straight directly to it. There's so much in the prayer book that if we paid attention, it would give us hope. And that's what a lot of people don't have today. They don't have enough hope. They're depressed, and some of them commit suicide. Yeah, some of them commit suicide. They don't know that there's something to look forward to. Really? There's life after death too? Nobody ever came back and told me that. So they use that as an excuse. Yes, but there's a lot of NDE, near-death experiences, where people have come back, have seen, have experienced something. There is something, there is some evidence, circumstantial evidence, but there's something there. Read about it. You'll be amazed. It will give you hope. And I have a lot of comments that I'm getting lately about some of the lectures that talk about these phenomena of life after death. Oh, it makes me feel much better that my long-lost husband, who I cared for him so much, is not completely gone, that eventually I will join him. It does something. It really does something. And what's all this about? This is stories. Stories, but same things with music. Music does something to us. And that's what Shlomo HaMelech is doing. That's what he's doing in this book, by putting together these ideas in the form of a song, in a beautiful way to express in the strongest terms possible how significant that connection with Hashem is. So Shir HaShirim is not studied enough, but it is said. We have a tradition to say it during Pesach, Shabbat Chol HaMoed, because on Pesach, on Passover, we celebrate the redemption from Egypt. So because we're dealing with the redemption, we're focused on the redemption, that this is a great time to talk about the final redemption. So we have a custom to read it then. There's another interesting custom you may have seen, to say Shir HaShirim right before Shabbat, right before the beginning of Shabbat on Friday afternoon, either before Mincha, after Mincha. That is more Kabbalistic in nature. It's brought down in the Kabbalah that there are 117 verses, Pesukim, in Shir HaShirim. What's 117? The significance of the 117 is that there are 117 hours in the week that the Gehenom is operational. Shabbat is not operational exactly. Neither is it during the hours of prayer. So if you subtract from the number of hours in a week, the Shabbat, and 1.5 hours per prayer, and we have Shachrit bin Hainavit, right? You will get 117. So we learn from that, the Kabbalah teaches, that this is a protection from Gehenom. People who have sinned and made many mistakes, they need protection. There's all kinds of things that they can do to protect themselves. So during certain hours, there is no Gehenom. So if you say the Shir HaShirim, which has 117 verses, in a way, it will also protect you. And when I say protection, it also could be that it will cool off. It will cool the Gehenom. Some people, when they go to Gehenom, you know, it's very painful. And because they have certain merits, those merits will actually cool it for them. So instead of 850 degrees, they make it 300 degrees. It's still hot, but it's not as hot. But anyway, that's just a side remark. It is powerful, just like Tehillim is very powerful, by the way. Don't forget about Tehillim. That's something that, if said every day, can do a lot for us. But here we learn that even Shir HaShirim, right before Shabbat, it's a beautiful time to say it as we enter the Shabbat. So, in saying Shir HaShirim, what do we want to accomplish? One of the things that we want to accomplish, I said earlier, is a connection, of course. But why? Why more now than ever, through the songs, through these words? It is very possible that an individual throughout his life, or a nation, may have done so much wrong that they feel that they're so soiled and dirty. Here we're talking about the Jewish people. We may think or feel that even though Hashem made that commitment to us, we got so dirty. Imagine a bride entering the hall and her beautiful gown has ketchup on it or something else. She's ashamed, she's embarrassed. So the Kabbalah explains that that's how some people will feel when they head upstairs. They're ashamed. They're ashamed. They want to connect, they want to be close to the Divine Presence upstairs, but they feel ashamed, embarrassed of their sins. That similar shame can sometimes be experienced here when a person does realize and come to the recognition, he is aware, I've done so much wrong. Is it possible for me to cleanse myself? So Shir HaShirim does remind us that, yes, in the same way Hashem promised never to let go of you, despite your sins, don't feel bad. He made a promise, you got engaged, and He's not canceling that wedding date, right? The Mashiach will come, the Geulah will come. In the same way, don't feel bad, even though, of course, you should feel pained and embarrassed about what you did wrong, but don't think that that's going to ruin your relationship with Him forever. Right now, it's weak. Yes, He's upset at you, but you can clean yourself. So if we have those ideas that Teshuvah is really something that works, it will give us hope. It will make us realize that it is possible to make a U-turn. No reason to be sad and depressed. It's brought down in the Gemara too that even angels say Shira, even angels sing to Hashem. Malachi HaSharet sing to Hashem in the Rekia, in the heaven called Ma'on, the seven heavens. By the way, that's where perhaps the expression comes, being in seventh heaven, being at the highest heaven of all. But in one of those heavens, which is called Ma'on, the angels are there on a regular daily basis singing to Hashem. So we see that singing is a way, a powerful way, to connect. They also connect to Hashem in a very pure way, right? They don't need to, but still, it's something that we can learn from. This is what they do. This is how they serve Hashem. This is how they maintain that connection with Him. But it's not just a connection. Remember, I said earlier that when we're talking about music, the whole is greater than the sum of all its parts. You've heard of that saying, Aristotle? The whole is greater than the sum of all its parts. So there's a lot of words, parts, but what is the whole? The whole is a composition. When you hear music, you're not just hearing one stanza, you're not just hearing one part, you're hearing hopefully all the instruments, you're hearing the entire music piece, and that is what hopefully will have an effect. The Malachim, in expressing whatever it is that they express, they create something with that too. It's a composition, it's a creation. It's not just a connection, but it's a creation, it's a composition. And that composition is beautiful. And the way they do it, we can do it too. But the way to do it is to know why I want to do this. You're getting married, you want to make a beautiful composition. Of course, you want to have a beautiful life, but what for? So much investment, so much goes into the relationship, it's not easy. You have to know why. If you know why, it's easier. What is the purpose of all of this? What is the purpose of having a connection with Hashem? And one of the things that we will gain when we learn through Shir HaShirim is we realize that yes, life has ups and downs, just like music has ups and downs. But that's why life is a song. And when you hear a song, what do? You dance along with it. So when we have our ups and downs, you just dance along with it. How am I going to do that? Well, just listen to the music, see how beautiful it is, and realize there's a lot more to what the eye sees. Obviously, that takes a lot of learning. But ultimately, the melody leads to something. As I said earlier, it has an effect. And that effect, hopefully, will be to bring out memories, to stimulate us. That's the intent, hopefully. And if it's beautiful music, it will have that kind of an effect. Just want to finish with a few ideas, a quote that I saw that is very, very true. We all need strength, we all need encouragement, especially during those times that I mentioned that we're down. Beautiful quote. There were times in life that the only thing I had was a song, and it carried me. That's all I had was a song, and it carried me. It helped me bear the pain and deal with the issues. A song. Yes, music is very powerful, and I encourage people to listen to good music from time to time to elevate their spirit, to bring up their mood. It's very, very special. I just want to remind you and warn you, when you do listen to music, be careful not to listen to music coming from impure forces, from impure sources, from people who are bad. Bad meaning that they're not good people. They do all kinds of terrible things. They're sinful. Because that music, even though they say it's music to the ear, will have a bad effect, a bad influence. Even though the music might be exciting, if it's coming from a bad source, be careful. Don't listen to songs or music that's coming from a bad source. Hopefully, by listening to good music, to powerful music, by listening to holy songs, hopefully they will, Bezat Hashem, God willing, inspire us to achieve greater heights. That is something that we all should want. Aspire to reach greater heights, become a better person, perfect ourselves. We need the tools for that. Music, the songs, are some of those tools. Especially if we understand the words, like in Tehillim. It's incredible what it can do to a person. It could bring tears. If it produces tears, that means it did something to you. So imagine, words can be powerful too. Words can, God forbid, be very hurtful. But words can also inspire us. Listen to good lectures, listen to good speeches, read good books that inspire. All of this is helpful. During our times where we're living through such unpredictable times, times that we cannot figure out, let's focus on the goal. Where is all this leading to? Bezat Hashem, very soon it's going to lead, it's already there, to the final redemption of the Gilad. We're going to see it. We're going to witness this. But until we get there, we should not be depressed, we should not be broken in spirit. We need to derive inspiration from good sources. Shir HaShirim is that tool that Shlomo HaMelech put together to give hope to the Jewish people and to others who want to connect to Hashem. You can do it. Amen.